So anyway, but David, yes, I know you from Toastmasters. I mean, I've only been in Toastmasters for like 6 months or so. You are the sort of elder statesman of Toastmasters. How long have you been in it?
Just about 2 years, actually. 2 years almost to the day.
So not quite elder statesman, just...
I'm a late starter, really. I mean, one of the things I said after a couple of meetings was, if only I discovered this sometime earlier, bearing in mind it started in 1924, I had plenty of time to discover it. But a late discovery. And actually, I mean, I regard this as one of the world's best kept secrets. So, you know, whatever we talk about, let's keep it among ourselves, okay?
Absolutely.
We don't do any advertising or anything.
None whatsoever. I mean, you know, there's the coverage for this is 1.5 million. But if you're listening to it, you are the one person listening to it, so that's fine. So yes. What got? How did you find out about it in the first place?
There's a particular character. Can I mention names?
Yeah.
And he's a very accomplished actor called Roger Harding. And I bumped into him at various different meetings where he would announce how interesting and how useful and et cetera, et cetera. And so I've been hearing about it probably about 6 months before I actually appeared and came along. And the thing that hooked me, and I find that everybody gets something different from Toastmasters. The thing that got me was the impromptu speaking.
Yeah.
That's really my challenge. I mean, I've been speaking for talking for a living for, you know, for a long time. I won't give you numbers because I'll scare the listeners away. But I've been taught as a salesman, so generally speaking in very small groups or one to one, no problem with that. Where from time to time I've failed over the years was the time when I should have said a few words, you know, at somebody's wedding or, you know,
funeral,
a gap. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, yeah, funeral, yeah.
Someone just died. Yeah, it's always good.
And meetings when I should have asked a question, that sort of thing. And I sat there and I thought, I should ask a question. I'm not going to. And I suffered from that.
Mm.
It may sound trivial, but I mean, you know, time and time again, and probably career-wise, I suffered as well, because the guys who did jump up, even if it was a stupid question, but they were usually a stupid question.
Mm.
That didn't matter. The fact that they were up on their feet asking the question.
Mm.
And I didn't do that, and that's the main thing I got out of Toastmasters fairly quickly. First time I went there, they said, David, you know, tell us, you know, you're advising Santa Claus on his sex life or something. What would you say? And I had to talk. I can't remember what I said.
I can't remember what the first question I got when I first went to Toastmasters, but I hadn't had any information about Toastmasters before I arrived. So I had no idea, and I turned up for the first session, and and the moment whoever was in charge that day, when they said, Kate, what happens is when you arrive, the start of the meeting, they get the guests to introduce themselves. So
mm-hmm.
I gave my name, and you say what you do, and I'm a stand-up comedian, at which point they're just like, definitely use the table topics. I had no idea that this was going to happen. So the first thing that happened was they asked this question to someone there, and one of the guys who was in Toastmasters went up to talk. The second question asked, and they said, and welcome Al Cowie to the stage or to the front. And it was great fun. I managed to get plenty of laughs. I think I compared how similar women might be to horses, which, you know, it's just what came to my mind. If there's any women out there, I don't think you are like horses. But that does... See, I'm already digging myself back into a hole.
Have you ridden a few horses, then?
I'm currently burning my bra. I'm furious.